Okay, so we have seen how in an n-dimensional vector space, if you consider an arbitrary, set of n linearly independent vectors, these form a basis for you. And a basis is a convenient, set to work with, because any vector in that space can be represented as a linear combination of vectors from this basis, right? Now, it turns out that although we can form bases in many different ways, infinitely many ways, there are, certain kinds of bases which are more convenient, right? So these are called orthonormal bases, right? One example is, from two-dimensional vectors. We know that EX and EY, right? We have, perhaps without thinking about this, we have been using EX and EY to form the basis for all vectors in 2D, right? So the unit vector along the X direction and the unit vector along the Y direction. But in our recent discussion, we have seen that, EX and EX plus Y is an equally valid basis. We could have represented all our physics in terms of EX and EX plus EY, or EX plus Y and EX plus 3EY, for example, or any two linearly independent vectors from the plane is a valid basis. But the reason why EX and EY is a particularly convenient basis is because, there is no component of EX along EY, and there is no component of EY along EX. So the idea here is that EX and EY are normal, or orthogonal to each other, and each of them are themselves normal, right? So what it means is each of the vectors of your basis is bringing, a unique piece of information for the set, right? Together, of course, they add up to the entire information of the overall space, and there is no redundancy. The fact that they are a basis implies that there is no collective redundancy. But if you make it an orthonormal basis, right, if all the basis vectors are orthogonal, it means that no vector carries any information contained in another vector. That's what the orthogonal basis does, right? So in this lecture, I am going to, describe a systematic method by which you can start with a basis of any kind. It's a basis, and that can be made into an, you can extract an orthonormal basis from this, right? So this is called the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization process. Okay, so yeah, so like I said, we call a set of vectors orthonormal if they're all mutually orthogonal to each other, right? And each vector is normalized. So making each vector normalized simply means if you take the inner product of a vector with itself, you have to get one, right? So this is, some added convenience, right? If you had not normalized it, even then, orthogonal already gives you some lot of convenience. So, but it's just one more step to normalize it as well. So we will show here how there's a systematic way to take any basis and make it and get an orthonormal basis. Okay, given a set B of m linearly independent vectors, a set S of mutually orthonormal vectors E1 to EM, right, can always be constructed. That's the statement. And so how do we do this? So let's start by picking up any one vector, right? Without loss of generality, we can just call it X1. So E1 is equal to X1 divided by its norm, right? So that E1 has been normalized. So the first step is to take any one vector and normalize it. And that will be your first element in the basis that you're creating. Now, the next thing to do is pick any other vector. Now, you could have picked, any one of the other m minus one vectors. There is no problem. There is a lot of choice in this, right? And in fact, you can create lots of different bases, orthonormal bases, using this method. So we will just show you that it is possible to find such an orthonormal basis in a systematic way. Now, pick X2 without loss of generality, and then what you do is you peel off, the component of X2 which lies along E1, right? So X2 is, so we, so this is what we do. How do we peel off the component of x2 along e1, you just take the inner product of x2 with e1, and then attach this vector e1, and then you remove that component from x2. So this is an intermediate vector which we call e2 prime, right? And to get e2, we have to just normalize this vector, right? We are interested in creating an orthonormal basis. So we have to normalize this e2 prime. So then we have e2 prime divided by square root of inner product of e2 prime with e2 prime. That's the second vector, e2, right? By construction, you can check that this vector e2 is going to be orthogonal to e1, and it's also normalized by construction, right? So the next step is similar, right? But now we have to peel off. We take the third vector, x3, without laws of generality, and then peel off, the component of x3 along x2 and the component of x3 along x1 and normalize it, and so on. And then you keep on doing this for the ith vector. The I plus one vector is going to be obtained by peeling off from the I plus one vector, components along every vector which has already been put into your box of orthonormal vectors that you're creating, right? So EI plus one prime is going to be XI plus one minus summation over J EJ XI plus one, the inner product, times the vector EJ, right? If you do this, and then you have to normalize it. You have to do EI plus one prime divided by square root of EI, inner product of EI plus one prime with EI plus one prime. And then, so evidently you can see that by construction, every vector in this set is orthogonal to every other vector. And also every vector has been explicitly normalized. So you have created an orthonormal basis. So that's how this method works. To convince yourself that this works out, I have given you an example which is very, very simple, and you might don't need an elaborate method for this. But let's say that you start with the vectors ex, ex plus y, and ex plus ey, plus ez, right? I'm thinking of a three-dimensional space, the usual kind of vectors. Ex is given, ex plus y, ey is given, and ex plus ey plus ez is given, right? You can, if you take the first vector to be A, itself, right? So it's already been normalized. So you have e1 is equal to ex. And then when you go to the second step, e2, to create e2, you're going to peel off, the component of B along ex, which in this case will turn out to be just ey. And then you go to the third vector C, you peel off the vector along A and the vector along B, so then you will get ez. So ex, ey, and ez is not just a basis, but it's an orthonormal basis. So I have given you a very trivial example, but even with this trivial example, let's say you start not with the vector A. I said even within the Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization process itself, you have a lot of choice. Suppose you start with the vector C, make C the vector e1, right? You have to do C divided by mod of C1, mod of C, that will be e1. And then maybe you can take B as e2. Using B, you'll have to find e2 and find A, use A to find e3, right? That would be left as a homework exercise. You could also start with B, try out various different combinations and see how you can generate different kinds of orthonormal bases, right? That's all for this lecture. Thank you.